This is the city, Los Angeles. The year is 2019. The buildings are a lot higher. All the decent folk live hundreds of stories up. No one in their right mind wants to be on the street. But you gotta be rich or a cop to own one of the flying cars. With most animals extinct, constant acid rain, and 106 million people, well, let's just say things haven't exactly gotten any better. The film being made is Blade Runner, a futuristic detective thriller starring Harrison Ford. Ford plays Rick Deckard, Blade Runner, a detective whose specialty is replicants, manufactured people no one else can tell from the real thing. When they go wrong, it's his job to stop them. It's not an easy job to like, but if you're a Blade Runner and you're good, they'll never let you quit.
Deckard has been with the police department before. Turns out that he's about to be pressed back into service in his old job, which involves the hunting and tracking of people. In this case, the people are not people, but replicants, flesh culture replicants, a kind of lab-grown result of gene splicing and growing human cells in a laboratory atmosphere. The eventual product would be something that looked just like a human being, and in the vision of this film, could be supplied with a memory and a belief in their own reality.
They were designed to copy human beings in every way except their emotions. And the designers reckoned that after a few years, they might develop their own emotional responses. You know, hate, love, fear, anger, envy. So they built in a fail-safe device.
Which is what?
For your lifespan.
You have 4 years to live, is basically, that's the total lifespan of a replicant. Only they're born without a capacity to know that or to understand that. When they find out that that's the fact, they get real mad.
The angels fell.
These replicants are a lot smarter and stronger than real humans. It's illegal for them to even be on this planet, let alone running around the city terrorizing innocent people. International star Rutger Hauer plays Batty, the brilliant leader of the escaped replicants.
They're sort of, and they're looking for something. I think they're looking for their, you know, their roots, which they don't have. And that they feel they don't have that much time.
Morphology, longevity, incept dates.
Don't know. I don't know such stuff.
I just do eyes. Just eyes, genetic design. Just eyes.
You Nexus, huh?
I design your eyes.
Sure. If only you could see what I've seen with your eyes.
They want more time. And my job is to find them and eliminate their threat.
The director is Ridley Scott, who gained prominence with his film Alien. Blade Runner, inspired by a classic Philip K. Dick novel, is a new challenge for Scott, in which he creates a unique vision of a possible future society, its technology, its people, and those who control them.
A Blade Runner is a kind of slang terminology for a bounty hunter, or an official exterminator, bureaucratic exterminator. And along his path of hunting replicants who happen to find their way into the city where they have no right to be, because the replicants are originally developed for off-world situations, both military, industrial, mining. They're kind of second-class generation developed for inhospitable environments, dangerous work, boring work, there will come a point maybe where if you're going to send an astronaut off into deep space where he'll never come back, and he knows he'll never come back, you may want to send a replicant instead.
Detective work hasn't changed much. You get too close to the truth and someone tries to change your mind. All it takes are guts, instinct, and intelligence. It's called trial and error. Mostly error.
Painful living fear, isn't it? Nothing is worse than having an itch you can never scratch.
Oh, I agree.
Wake up. Time to die.
Life's not all bad, though, if you've got a few of the modern conveniences. Like a spinner, one of the flying cars used by the police to patrol the city. A two-way video telephone.
I've had people walk out on me before, but not when I was being so charming. And why don't you come on down here and have a drink?
Or a detective's best friend, his Esper. A home computer that can search a room by scanning a photograph.
Enhance 34 to 46. Track 45 left. Stop. Give me a hard copy right there.
Like all detectives from Holmes to Marlowe, Deckard has to be able to adopt a quick personality change to handle new situations.
Excuse me, Miss Salome, can I talk to you for a minute? I'm from the American Federation of Variety Artists.
Oh, yeah?
I'm not here to make you join. No, ma'am. That's not my department. Actually, I'm from the Confidential Committee on Moral Abuses.
But on the street, there's no time to think twice. A Blade Runner has to smell trouble and act fast if he wants to stay alive.
One of the things about Deckard is that he's fighting a fear. It's not something he likes to do, to shoot people. He doesn't seem very easy with authority. And besides which, he seems to be on the losing end of almost every encounter. So he's reluctant, at best, to be doing what he's doing. But he does it pretty well.
Christ, Eckert, you look almost as bad as that skin job you left on the sidewalk.
I'm going home.
Could learn from this guy, guy. He's a goddamn one-man slaughterhouse, that's what he is. Four more to go. Come on, Gaff, let's go.
Three. There's three to go.
There's four.
Blade Runner is very simply a thriller. Has to be set in slightly future terms, 40 years' time, 40 or 50 years' time, really for the nature, the credibility of the plot. We chose to make the texture of the theme and the story, because it had to be set in the future, to try and make it as familiar as possible. We tried to make the character in a kind of Philip Marlowe environment. So, whilst we're looking 40 years in the future, it's very familiar in many respects and almost seems like 40 years ago. People's usually attempt to do future by presenting a rather bleak, austere, clean, pristine look, you know? And it could go that way, but I've got a feeling it's gonna go the other way. I mean, if you think of New York City right now, how impossible it is now to actually maintain some of these buildings, how expensive it's going to be to take down the Empire State Building, right? I mean, that's going to cost as much as building it. So I think with a little slip sideways, you could, say, take a city like Chicago, and especially New York, where you could just get total oversaturation, so where eventually you just retro things on the face of the building rather than having to pull half the side off to rehouse air conditioning or rewire it or something like that, because costs will get so high, it's going to be simple just to smack it on the outside. So maybe buildings will start to be designed from the inside out, you know, where all the engineering goes on the outside rather than from the inside, where it seems to be expensive.
But while the inner city decays, the suburbs have grown into sprawling industrial landscapes. Deckard's first lead takes him to the headquarters of the world's largest replicant manufacturer, the Tyrell Corporation. In Tyrell's office at the top of a 400-story pyramid, Deckard first encounters the girl. You know, the beautiful, mysterious type who always turn up in stories like this. Newcomer Sean Young plays Rachel.
I'm Rachel.
Deckard.
It seems you feel our work is not a benefit to the public.
Replicants are like any other machine. They're either a benefit or a hazard. They're a benefit, it's not my problem. At one point, Deckard is introduced to Rachel, whom he expects to be a human being. And at a certain point, he finds out that she's not. Not too big a shock for him. The shock for him is that with no place else to turn, she turns to him. And suddenly he's confronted with a woman in his life. You've got a little boy. He shows you his butterfly collection, plus the killing jar.
I take him to the doctor.
How many questions does it usually take to spot one?
I don't get it, Tyrell.
How many questions?
20, 30, cross-referenced.
It took more than 100 for Rachel, didn't it?
She doesn't know.
She's beginning to suspect, I think.
Suspect? How can it not know what it is?
Commerce is our goal here at Tyrell. More human than human is our motto. Rachel is an experiment, nothing more.
She knows how to handle this corporation that she works in. But when she gets in a situation, which she eventually does, where she has to relate to somebody physically, sexually, emotionally, she is as close to a virgin as anyone could be, because she's never had the experiences, regardless of how much of a woman she may look like. So she is in this situation with Deckard where he tries to kiss her and she runs away and Deckard stops her and is not exactly violent with her, but he realizes somewhere that this must come to pass, that they love one another, and she learns what emotions are because of the pain of the situation and the pain of having to feel something for the first time.
Sooner or later, it all boils down to the final struggle between the cop and his quarry. In Blade Runner, the confrontation scene between Deckard and Batty is a terrifying chase through decaying buildings and across rooftops hundreds of stories above the ground. The climax builds to a savage fight between Deckard and the super powerful replicant.
Six, seven, go to hell or go to heaven.
In 2019, man created man in his own image, a manufactured human. Hardware with soft flesh, programmed intelligence, frightening strength. The greatest invention has become the greatest threat.
Welcome to this year's convention. I'm Ridley Scott. I've just completed production on my latest picture since Alien. Blade Runner, starring Harrison Ford, as the classic hardboiled detective, is based on Philip Dick's novel, Do Androids Dream of Electric Sheep? We've prepared a special short film for you on the making of the picture, including the wizardry of Douglas Trumbull and the imaginative industrial designs of Sid Mead that helped us create this view of tomorrow.
Action, please. Action, everybody.
Blade Runner is very simply a thriller has to be set in slightly future terms, 40 years time, 40 or 50 years time, really for the nature, the credibility of the plot. We chose to make the texture of the theme and the story, because it had to be set in the future, to try and make it as familiar as possible. We tried to make the character in a kind of Philip Marlowe environment. So whilst we're looking 40 years in the future, it's very familiar in many respects and almost seems like 40 years ago.
Daphne, I want to ask you a few questions.
Yeah?
You ever see that girl before?
Never saw her.
How about this guy, transvestite, maybe?
You think I'm a pervert? Get out of here.
You ever buy snakes from the Egyptians, Captain?
Sure, all the time.
Licenses in order, pal.
The first ideas came after several meetings with Ridley and the art director and people that were responsible for estimating costs, and the overall idea to start with was a society where technology, life had become very difficult, and the mechanical fixtures, automobiles, trucks, buildings, the whole urban plant had become like a trap for people in the society. So I started off with very clean, designed concepts, and then successively layered on top of those initial ideas sort of a accumulation of detail and repairs and extra pieces of equipment that weren't the original equipment idea, and achieved this accumulated fix it because it won't run or has to run visual flavor, which is the whole essence of the film. So it isn't a new, shiny, futuristic society. It's a society where the normal supplies have broken down. The street level particularly had become like the sewers or the underside of the city, and being trapped on the street was not only just unromantic, but a thoroughly nasty way to spend your life. Because the street was simply a service access to the mega structures and the high rises that now comprise the city. And decent people really didn't live below 40 stories above the street. So then you start to get this accretion or an accumulation of detail, which are generators, vent pipes, a whole leftover kind of society that you're forced to live with because that's all there is. You can't afford to go up. And it takes a trend that is happening in some of the larger urban centers and accelerates it and caricatures it, makes it more brutal and more glamorous at each end of the scale than it is now. This parking meter is a kind of miniature example of the whole visual concept of accumulation. You'd start with a recognizable parking meter inside all this stuff. And it's there. That's the reason for adding on to it in the first place, for economy. When you no longer can accept coins or metal discs or whatever, you add a electronic register that accepts a magnetic card. The post-mechanical case becomes electrified so that if you touch it or try to attack it, you're electrocuted, which is a very brutal attack on you as a human. And by adding additional lights, larger scale, it's easier to see at night. It can be used for directing traffic down lanes, or maybe the lights change color, something like that.
This is brutal.
We've established the rule.
If you do it properly, they don't take great leaps and bounds. I mean, unless you're into truly into sort of fantasy terms like Flash Gordon or whatever you're doing. But if you're taking a step forward in terms of reality, which I'm trying to keep it as real as possible, even though it's very, let's say, rich and exotic and colorful, the step forward is small. Like if you take a car, one of the cars we've designed, the original cars we started off with were incredibly sort of sleek and streamlined, and even throwing all the dirt on them and rubbish on them under the sun, it still looked slightly futuristic, in inverted commas. And so we sort of backed down in the design concept. So they're quite familiar looking cars, except they're just a little exotic. So our step forward is small, but it's big, if you know what I mean.
The start off concept was that the society had produced vehicles that could fly. We had a specialized vehicle which only authorized people could use. That's the Spinner. It had to look different to make it believable that it could fly, first of all. And so the configuration of that vehicle is totally different than any of the other vehicles because it does a particular thing. It actually flies, lifts off the ground, lots of dust.
This is the interior Spinner set. When we shoot the exterior of the Spinner, none of this interior exists. This is strictly a set constructed for interior shooting of all of the readouts and all the detail on the exterior vehicles that you'll see driving around in the streets. None of this detail of interior is here. And one of the problems we have today is that on screens like this, where there will be readouts of movies, digital displays, maps, etc., for maneuvering the vehicle, it was just impossible because of the design of the vehicle to put in rear projection or live video screens or have 1, 2, 3, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, you know, 12 or 13 screens of information going on simultaneously. So what we've done is we've just lit these screens with white light from inside, and the camera will be shooting over these actors' shoulders here, and the shot will be what we call locked off. It's a static shot. And we're going to have wind effects and rain effects on the canopy of the vehicle from outside, lighting from outside, and a lot of practical lighting from inside. And then what we do in post-production is superimpose into these screens a lot of little movies of the readouts, which will be made later. Outside the window, we'll pull matte lines off the edges of the window here and all around the side doors, and then superimpose the city outside, trying to keep a balance between the natural light on the window, the rain on the window, and the city outside the window. So it's a pretty complicated, this is one of the most complicated composite mats in the picture, because even the city outside will be a number of elements. It'll be the city, foreground miniatures, which are 1 inch to the foot scale. It'll be half inch to the foot scale miniatures beyond that, quarter inch to the foot scale miniatures beyond that, a painted backing beyond that, and then between you and it, maybe 6 or 8 other spinners all maneuvering that are all optically superimposed together. So the plate that'll be out the window here alone will probably consist of maybe a dozen film elements all composited together. One of the most fortunate things for us on this picture is that Ridley is quite a good illustrator and does all his own drawings. So we can sit there in a meeting and he can draw for you right before your very eyes what he wants to see. And from that, we can extrapolate what's special effects, what's foreground, what's background, and he can guess at the length of a shot or the angle of a lens, and we all sort of talk that technical language. And then from that, we make a plan of what the shot will consist of, and then that plan has to do with the fact that we have to construct a set like this separate from the exterior spinners, when it will be shot and how that relates to when the effects will be shot.
When we set out to do this film, we decided to make, there was a taboo word, but I may as well use the taboo word because it's somehow, the word was android. And I said, anybody uses the word android gets their head broken with a baseball bat, okay? Because it sets up all sorts of preconceptions of the kind of film it could be, right? And yet the word android, in a way, is really a man-made development on, let's say, a robot, biomechanoid, android. An android may actually be human. I mean, may actually be flesh and blood, genetically structured, okay? So we simply decided to not use the word because it's been overused and misused. And so we developed our own word, which is the word replicant, which is essentially a human being. That's the odd dichotomy of the whole story, of the fact that the detective job is in one sense a kind of policer, but also an exterminator if necessary. Not a bounty hunter, he's a bureaucrat, he's paid to do the job. And along his path of hunting of replicants who happen to find their way into the city where they have no right to be, because the replicants are originally developed for off-world situations, both military, industrial, mining. They're kind of second-class generation developed for inhospitable environments, dangerous work, boring work. There will come a point maybe where if you're going to send an astronaut off into deep space where he'll never come back, and he knows he'll never come back, you may want to send a replicant instead. It's a kind of tongue-in-cheek idea of what could actually happen if industry becomes so large, a conglomerate became so large that let's say it developed into aerospace, let's say it developed into space probes looking for mining, and another side to that company could be genetics and genetic engineering. So the associations with genetic engineering could quite easily be the development of the first human, which is right on the doorstep right now. That's a look at what we've been up to for the last year. It was a very exciting project for us, and we hope you will like Blade Runner. Enjoy the convention.